Well, thank you all for joining me today. Good afternoon. I'm Under Sheriff Christopher Darcy, and I really wanted to address our community this afternoon about the verdict in the Derek Chauvin trial today. The death of Mr. Floyd has become a seminal event in law enforcement and within our community. The Chauvin trial brought up a bigger issue about American policing, and we're always willing to have that conversation here at the LVMPD. We've been having this conversation for nearly a decade when we began reforms here on our agency. Substantive changes are not just procedural, they're cultural. We have worked hard to ensure that there is no environment on this police department for an officer like Derek Chauvin. Many changes have happened over time with the guidance and input of community members and representatives from our Metro Multicultural Advisory Council. These members have really helped us learn and implement change and have championed some of our most important policy changes. In addition, we willingly work with these faith-based partners, community groups, and even some of our critics. I want to say that I am so happy that we have some of our community partners here with us today, standing over here to my right. Mujahideen Ramadan has been working with Metro since I was a very young officer brought up on this agency. And you can tell that's a long time ago with the gray hair. But I remember sitting there as like a brand new cop, and he was teaching us about diversity and biases and how we can overcome those by working together. Next to Mr. Ramadan, we have other members of our community that came to us today and said, we would like to be part of this. We would like to be part of what's going on with your organization. So I want to thank Reverend Jackson, Pastor Gaston, Reverend Wright, and Pastor Cherry, and Maria Barnes for taking time out of their day to come here and be with us. So thank you very much. With our partners, we've been able to start working on recruiting a more diverse police officer, so our agency will better reflect the community that we serve. We've been making changes. Prior to Mr. Floyd's death, Metro made several changes in our use of force policy and training policies. To name a few, mandating a recovery position, making that mandatory so that when we have a suspect in custody, we ensure that they are breathing and their breathing is not restricted when they're in custody. Mandating a duty to intervene and a duty to report when an officer sees another officer or a supervisor sees an officer doing something improper. Providing more direction in what de-escalation really means and training our folks on how to de-escalate, making that part of the fabric of everything we do. Every call we go on, we talk about de-escalation. We've prohibited chokeholds and neck restraints. We've made changes. And we've learned over time that we have a responsibility to listen to our community, to you, to learn from our community, and to change. The strength of our police department comes from this community. It comes from you, the public. Among our many duties to the public, we're here to protect the First Amendment right to assemble, protest. Some of you may choose to exercise that right today. And we stand here with you, the community, to ensure hand in hand that they remain peaceful and that the message is heard. This last year has really illustrated a number of issues that really impact our community. And the death of Mr. Floyd was a tragic event that should not have happened. Having said that, today a jury has spoken and held a police officer accountable for their conduct. Our hope at the LVMPD, as we continue to work collaboratively, and we continue to earn the public's trust. So I want to thank you all for being here. I want to thank the members of the community. I want to thank my officers that are here, as well as members of the media and the public. I am willing to take some questions if you have any questions of me today. A couple questions.
Tom Quinones from Channel 13. I'm curious, going forward, will you guys be using this case, the Derek Chauvin case, in your training now moving forward?
Well, I will tell you this. That's not within our training, and I think there's not a person on this planet that looks at that and thinks that that's okay. So that's never been part of our training, nor will it be part of our training. But yes, obviously, the illustration of what not following policy, I think, sends a powerful message. Yes, sir.
As a veteran police officer and as a civilian, a community member, what was your feeling when you saw that video, and what was your feeling today when the jury came back with a guilty?
Well, I will tell you, the day that I first saw that video, I had another employee who's now a deputy chief come into my office and said, "You have to see this video. It's the most disturbing thing I've ever seen." And he says, "I think a city is going to burn." And I looked at it. I thought I was just shocked. So it was just utter shock and disappointment. And then today I would say that the feeling is relief. Yes?
Many people today are calling this the first real victory when it comes to seeing an officer held accountable in this country for the death of an African American. Also during this trial, we've heard a lot of talk about the blue wall of silence. What is Metro Police's reaction to the conversation that's happened about the blue wall of silence, and what is being done to make sure that officers, one thing to, you know, mandate, but to make sure that officers are actually reporting when something happens?
Correct. So a couple things to that. Number one, we don't tolerate it. We mandate that it does not occur, and we put it in policy. But like I said, you have to change a culture. So the only way to change that culture is to enforce the policy and hold those accountable that don't follow it. Right? We train our folks. We tell them what the standard is. We provide them direction on what to do and how to really attain that standard. And now we have a policy that really nails it down, and then we follow through. Hold them accountable. And we have tracking mechanisms. Obviously, when we see people that have complaints, we'll hold them accountable. So I'll take one more question.
Yeah, we're coming in with Channel 8. Okay. You talk about these relationships with the community, community leaders, faith leaders. You know, from this point moving forward, how will you continue to have conversations with them, but maybe build on that further now that this, you know, groundswell has happened over the past year? What's the big change, the big movement heading forward?
So I think the important thing is to continue to have the conversation. This provides us a genesis to continue having conversations about policing in America and policing in our community. And I think this draws more attention to the importance of our community relationships, whether it's our MMAC council or we're involved in thousands of community partnerships, right? Every day we have that opportunity to make a connection with a member of the public. And I think this serves as a reminder that we're there to serve the public and that we work cooperatively with them, and that we continue to make those changes in law enforcement the public expects. So thank you very much, and then we'll be available for some questions afterwards. I know the folks from the community will be here as well. So thank you for your time today.